Like a giant sweeping across the seas, he stormed through the frontiers of his art. Those who come after him cannot continue, but must begin afresh, for he reached where art itself ends. It's very good, isn't it? Really good.
Beethoven.
Yes, well, of course.
I suppose you know who wrote it.
Yes, I can tell you. It was written by the poet Grillparzer, to be spoken at Beethoven's funeral in 1827.
You also know where it was spoken?
No, but I suppose at the church or the cemetery or wherever.
Which cemetery?
I've no idea which.
Well, it's not the central cemetery where everybody is likely to send you.
Well, where is it then? I'll be in Vienna before you, so could you show me?
Sure. It's a very small cemetery, and no one is being buried there anymore, and that's why it's very hard to find. Don't depend on the taxi driver. Just ask him to drive along this road and take a right turn.
Wait a minute.
Beringerstrasse, it's called. Then he turns right, and then you go up here, and it's on the left-hand side.
I found the cemetery, and it took a bit of finding, too. And outside that gateway behind me, of course, no houses there, no traffic, there was a huge crowd, 20,000 people, they say. And standing in the gateway, Anschütz, a very famous actor of the time, delivered the funeral oration. And a remarkable oration it was, too, written by Grillparzer, an equally famous poet. It's an extraordinary speech, and I'd like to read some of it to you. As we surround this grave, we mourn, an entire nation mourns with us. The heir to the eternal fame of Handel and Bach, of Haydn and Mozart, is no more. See, that's very interesting. His contemporaries already knew his place in history and that of the others. We stand weeping for the torn strings, for the fading of the sound. The sound, let me thus refer to him, for he was an artist, and by art alone he lived. Will anyone stand next to him? It's wonderful. Like a giant sweeping across the seas, he stormed through the frontiers of his art. Those who come after him cannot continue, but must begin afresh, for he reached where art itself ends.
Fascination we have with Beethoven. Libraries have been filled with books about him. Generations of scholars have scrutinized every stroke of his pen. Concert seasons wouldn't and couldn't get off the ground without him. What is this fascination we have with him? Well, there are many answers, and I can only give you mine. I think it comes from his deep humanity, and that he was able to express it in music. You just heard this music. The music of a man who suffered greatly, a man of uncommon willpower and strength. I first heard it when I was 5 years old and have been performing it ever since. Understanding Beethoven is difficult, even after this many years. Yet his letters tell us how desperate he was to be understood. Even in his lifetime, he could express himself only through music. This is Bonn today, the city where he was born more than 200 years ago. We came here to trace Beethoven's path. This has been done before, often. Going back to the past is the obvious thing to do. The trouble is that in order to understand him, it is not enough to go back. We have to go ahead. Way ahead into the future. Surprised? I thought you might be. However, this is the house where he was born. This place reminds me of all the bits of information I had read as a child. That smallpox marred his face for life. His father drank, his mother was melancholy. But he revered his grandfather, the first musician in the family. His childhood was neither happy nor glamorous. No world tours. No royal admirers, just loneliness, which you still sense in this room where he was born. There were good times, too. At the age of 11, he was brought to a fine teacher, Nefe, who introduced Bach's music to him and became his mentor. Nefe gave him books, literature, philosophy. He was a fine man. But I would like to tell you about a very special relationship, one which endured throughout his life. It was with the River Rhine. How, you might ask, does one have a relationship with a river? Well, the Rhine isn't just any river. While Nefe became a source of knowledge, the Rhine was a whole magic world. More legends surround this waterway than any other. Lorelei, the Nibelungs, which you know through Wagner's Ring, countless poems throughout the centuries. One has the feeling that this river speaks. So does Beethoven's music.
Thank you.
In his letters, Beethoven refers to the river as Father Rhine. Father Rhine. Surely others who grew up around here also must feel some unusual relationship. Through the ages, especially before trains, cars, mass communication came into being, this river was much more than just a source of legends. It was the main artery of Western Europe. It carried goods, ideas, people, even music. Entire communities lived off the trade, and the vineyards, which still produce some of the finest wine. Beethoven enjoyed them as much as anybody else. Beethoven was only 22 when he left Bonn and the Rhine forever and came to this proudest and richest of musical centers, Vienna. What a difference. Bonn was the center of a small German province. Vienna, the capital of the Austrian Empire. 22. Only 22 or 22 already? He seemed little more than a promise at this time, if one considers the accomplishments at a similar age, of Schubert, of Mendelssohn, of Chopin, not to mention his own ideal, Mozart, with whom he so much wanted to study. But Mozart had died just a year before, and thus Beethoven came here to study with Haydn and to prove himself worthy of this beautiful and elegant capital, teeming with accomplished musicians and suffering no shortage of masters. City exude that brought forth a tree from the seed in a few years' time. Suddenly, at the age of 25, Beethoven was a mature composer, and during the following 5 years, he produced enough both in quantity and in quality to lay a justified claim to the throne becoming vacant with Mozart's passing and with Haydn's old age. He was pouring out sonatas, string quartets, concertos, his first symphony. Some of his music, and certainly his manners, were controversial, but he quickly acquired the lifelong admiration, affection, and loyalty of those who mattered. And he made no secret of his intention to turn the world of music upside down. So full of life, so secure in his power, as if the awkwardness, the dark, pockmarked complexion, the unmanageable hair had all been left in Bonn. As if the loss of both parents and of Nefe, his beloved teacher, had forced him to be a man and a master in his own right at last. But it was not his fate to savor the carefree moments. And it seems he had known that all along. Such music. Deafness had already begun to drive a wedge between him and the world around. Yet the astonishing fact is that in his isolation, this man could create the sounds of nature when he no longer heard them. Also see the fires of hell as if he had been there. Able to celebrate the triumph of man for all time to come. Just as his meteoric rise began, as he was being welcomed everywhere, as publishers were clamoring for anything he composed, so grew his fear of being among people. He was not yet 30 when his hearing, no doubt about it, became increasingly impaired. How could he, a musician who ought to have better ears than anyone else, hope to escape discovery? Or plead for sympathy and risk humiliation if others found out? For years he had hoped the affliction would pass. For years he filled his mind and his notepaper with music which simply refused to take notice. Thank you. humor in music is a rare gift. It is difficult to compose, difficult to perform, and sometimes difficult even to notice. Beethoven had a wonderful sense of humor, a quality often overlooked. The miracle is that he was able to retain it in the face of irreversible deafness. To say it again, I don't know how he found it in his heart to write music like this under such circumstances, because by about 1800, hope had given way to despair. Having kept the illness to himself all these years, he finally decided to tell some close friends. Then, it seems, he addressed himself to the world. He wrote a letter here in this house, in that room, and because the house stands in Heiligenstadt, a city then just a few miles outside Vienna, it came to be known as the Heiligenstadt Testament. It's not really a testament, I don't know what it is. It's a letter addressed to his brothers, speaking really to the whole world. It's a plea, perhaps most of all it is a farewell to a society which knew so little, nothing really, of his plight, and which tended to misjudge his every deed.
Because he fled the world, they called him hostile. Because he hid his feelings, they thought he had none.
And ill-tempered, you do me injustice. Little do you know my humiliation when someone next to me praises the shepherd's song and I hear nothing. How often I feel I should put an end to my life.
Well, this is a suicide note, isn't it? At any rate, it's a man getting ready to die.
I'm not sure. I think he just needed to write down these thoughts.
And what happened to the document, the letter itself, after he'd written it?
It ended up in a drawer, and it wasn't found until months and months after his death, 25 years after he had written it.
Well, if he kept it that long, he must have felt it had a significance for him.
I think he wanted to remember how close he came. But Beethoven never intended to die or to give up. Even in his most desperate moment, he wrote to a friend, "I shall grab fate by the throat. I shall not be subdued." Having lost the war down here, he sought worthier opponents high above. A man dared to defy the gods.
He unlocked the door to that terrifying realm where the civilized submits to the tyranny of cosmic forces, violent, warring. Thank you.
had been on his way to become the most celebrated composer of his time. Now, he was to be much more.
He was indeed. He was to become a symbol. A symbol for all time.
Quite.
Well then, are you convinced that the despair, the mood that produced this testament was the turning point?
It had to be. You see, he had just come face to face with the inevitable. It required superhuman strength to continue living. He had to, and he did find it.
I can't imagine it. How does a musician, a composer, face the future knowing that he's locked forever into silence?
I suppose he felt, perhaps he knew already, that his triumph would be assured, that fate would have to yield, if only this one time.
London, from way outside, up in the north of England, and for the first time in my life, I saw Shakespeare acted greatly. I'd read Shakespeare before, but I'd never really seen him acted well, and I suddenly did. And it was an extraordinary experience. And at the same time, I heard Beethoven played superbly, whether it was the sonatas, or whether it was the quartets or the concerti. And the two men, one a musician and the other one a playwright, a poet, they seemed to me, at that impressionable age of 17, to share something very definite, and that was the human spirit stretched to its utmost in every direction.
You know that Beethoven read a lot of Shakespeare. He read all the German classics very early because he had this teacher in Bonn who led him to the books. But throughout his life he read Shakespeare. And there is an interesting story. One of his piano sonatas acquired the nickname Tempest. And people always wonder how. Well, he had this private secretary, Schindler, who spent many of his last years with him. And Schindler was intrigued by this piece. It's a very unusual piece because it doesn't really have a beginning, not even much of an end, but rather than presenting a theme as you would have at the beginning of a piece of music, it's born in thunder and lightning, and you see him searching for this theme. It's an extraordinary piece. And so Schindler said to him, "What does this piece represent? Where did you get the idea?" And according to Schindler, Beethoven said, "Just read Shakespeare's Tempest." And the other night, I was reading the Tempest once again, and I said to myself, "Well, there is Caliban. What would you say is the most pertinent characteristic of Caliban?
Oh, heavens, I don't know. He's called a misshapen monster.
Misshapen monster, that's good enough.
Yes.
Because Beethoven must have appeared to some as a monster, and I wonder if he even thought of himself occasionally as one. Certainly, if not an outcast, but at least standing outside society, outside the norm. Wouldn't you say?
Yes.
And deafness having struck him, he found himself perhaps on an island, like Prospero.
An island inside his head?
An island inside his head. So I was trying to look for something like this in the play. And I think I found it. The passage goes something like this. Tell you what, you promised not to play the piano, so I'm not going to read Shakespeare, all right? Could you?
What?
It's there.
Yes, Caliban. He says he's a monster. He said, but he's a touching monster, very touching. He says, the isle is full of noises, sounds and sweet airs that give delight and hurt not. Sometimes 1,000 twangling instruments will hum about mine ears, and sometime voices that if I then had waked after long sleep will make me sleep again. And then in dreaming, the clouds methought would open and show riches ready to drop upon me, that when I waked, I cried to dream again. Well, it's terribly moving. If Beethoven indeed saw himself as Caliban, it's very moving, isn't it?
It's just an idea, but you wanted to see the room in which the Heiligenstadt Testament was written.
I do.
There it is. Please don't expect too much. It's just an empty room now, but it's full of feelings, so I think you should take a look and stay a while.
All right, I will. So, see you later then.
Restless and impatient as ever, he kept moving from place to place, 71 times in all, if you want to know. In fact, he stayed at so many houses in and around Vienna that every other street could display the sign, Ludwig van Beethoven lived here. Restless and grand. The world as it had been was crumbling. Revolution in France, the colonies rising against the British Empire, industrialization. And the people who molded this era. Napoleon in Paris, Goethe in Weimar, Franklin and Jefferson in America. Who would escape their impact? Nothing could ever be the same again. As always, some resisted. Beethoven surged ahead with irresistible force. In a sense, his fight was over. Never again do we hear this degree of inner turbulence, of conflict, in Beethoven's music. The tranquility of the very next piece he composed tells the story much better than I can. He was now master of himself and master of the musical substance. How should I put it? He could mold music in any shape. He could unleash its forces at will. He could play with it, with the abandon and gentleness of a giant. For nearly 20 years now, nothing could diminish his creativity. He lived for the sake of writing music. Even in his darkest hour, inspiration never left him. Then, for 2 years, he hardly composed anything of significance. Did he suddenly run out of new ideas? No, only everything was turned inward as he walked along this brook, under these trees, day after day. The phenomenon which followed when he reemerged is referred to by scholars as Beethoven's last period. Poets prefer to call it the transfiguration which followed the catastrophe. He began by giving detailed instructions to the performer, instructions which serve notice that from now on the emotional content was to be more important than anything else. He wrote fewer and fewer notes, each meaning more and more. Perhaps in this intimate world he found the woman his letters call immortal beloved. Whoever she was, they were never united. Her identity is still hidden. Went on to create a unique monument to music and to one man's faith in the human spirit. It is known as the Ninth Symphony.
Oh,
he retreat to some remote place of his own? Or did he take himself into the future, his and ours, as I had suggested early on? The future is not embodied in dissonant chords or in strange sources of sound. The future is in ideas, which have yet to be understood and implemented. There is no question in my mind that much in the late sonatas was conceived for a piano of the future. Do you remember this? When he finished this piece, he said, "Mark my words, I have written something people will want to hear even 50 years after my death." At the time, this was quite a pretentious statement. As it turned out, Beethoven was modest. It took that many years for an instrument to be developed which could begin to cope with the power and with the range of colors required. The same can be said about the symphony orchestra. Both the size and the quality of players took some time to catch up with his demands. Technology, since, has brought Beethoven's music to millions everywhere. He was hoping for 50 years. It has now been more than 150. The fascination remains. Some of his music still eludes us. Some of his music still eludes us. I wonder if it always will. You just heard two violins, a viola and a cello, a string quartet. Interesting, despite the advance of every other kind of instrument, these, in this particular combination, remain constant from the 18th to the 20th century, from Haydn to Bartók. Composers have always considered the string quartet to be the most perfect medium of musical expression. Beethoven turned to them for his last messages. By now he was very far from the rest of us. For 30 years he lived the nightmare of hearing less and less each day until there was silence. There he found the essence of music, the sounds which perhaps only those can perceive whose ears are shielded from the outside world.
The isle is full of noises, sounds and sweet airs that give delight and hurt not. Sometimes 1,000 twangling instruments will hum about mine ears, and sometime voices that if I then had waked after long sleep will make me sleep again. And then in dreaming, the clouds methought would open and show riches ready to drop upon me, that when I waked, I cried to dream again.
There can be little doubt that Beethoven knew he was writing his last composition. As I was on my way back to Heiligenstadt, I couldn't help thinking about those remarkable people of his own time who understood who and what Beethoven was. A great deal of admiration is due to those people.
Many?
Well, think of the tens of thousands at the funeral. And they weren't all musicians, nor was Grillparzer, whose speech you liked so much. He was a poet. Incidentally, I don't know if I ever mentioned it to you, or you might have read it, that church authorities in the last moment denied permission for the speech to be spoken at a grave.
Why?
I can only guess. But it was not a part of the traditional service, a secular speech.
And they didn't want it spoken on consecrated ground?
I guess not, but let's be fair. A week later, there was an official service and Mozart's Requiem was played.
Tell me, Beethoven never composed a Requiem himself, did he?
No, he didn't, but he composed some passages a few years back which I would have considered perfectly suitable for such an occasion. This is how I see him, saying farewell to us. A tragic figure, yes, but one whose will is unbroken and whose head is raised in defiance, in passion and in strength. How does Grillparzer say? Thus he was, thus he died.
And thus he shall live always. And you who accompanied us on this journey, allay your sorrow. You have not lost, but forever regained him. And if ever the power of his creations overwhelms you like an approaching storm, if your tears will flow amidst a new generation yet unborn, remember this hour and think we were there when they buried him, and when he died, we wept. The gate of life must close behind us all. Only then will the portals open to the temple of immortality. There he now stands, beside the great of all time, untouchable forever.